Praise God. We welcome you to the meeting today. We thank God for bringing you to the Solution Hour. Let's note, Solution Hour is the time of obtaining the key that opens the door of blessings and closes the door of curses. We're going to pray together now. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we adore you for this meeting. We thank you for the Solution Hour. Thank you for the ways that you have been blessing us every time we come before your presence. We thank you for this hour. Those who are listening to the voice right now on their social media, on Instagram or in whatever area they are listening to it. Lord, we pray that your blessings will reach and touch everyone. We ask that your Holy Spirit will take control. Thank you, Eternal Father, because of what you are doing and you continue to do. Blessed be your name, because we believe that you have answered our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Once again, you are welcome. Today we are looking at the message, let this gate open. Let this gate open. We have our text in Psalm 24, verses 7 and 8. Let's open. Lift up your heads, O ye gate, and be lifted up, O ancient days, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. In this passage of the scriptures, we are having a call for gate to open, because you remember that this month we are looking at perfect radiance. And last week we opened by the challenge that God has given unto us to recharge for radiance. And in this passage he said, lift up your heads, O gates. Gate is the entryway into something. And because it's an entryway, it emphasizes a kind of public place. That is the gate. And in this passage, you can see communication to the gate. Lift up your head, O gates. And then you see, apart from the gate being asked to lift up its head, it means that there is control. Apart from communicating with the gate, there is control. Control to allow who to come in, who not to come in, through the gate. So the control is highly essential. Apart from the control, because the gate is to protect the military attack, the intrusion of unwanted strangers and guests into the city can come in through the gate. And then you now see that communication is there, control is there, then you see that the gate is the connection between the city and the external world. So in essence, you see communication, you see control, and then you see connection in the gate. So when we are talking about the gate, we are talking about communication. We are talking about control. We are talking about connection. All these three is important and makes up the gate. And in the Old Testament, gatekeepers are very, very essential because they are the connector between the city and its external world. They are the announcer of any problem coming into the city. They are the one to tell us what is happening, what is going on in the city. So if you look at our passage again, you see a command coming from the communication, and you command and talk through the communication. Lift up your head, O gate. Not only command, we see compliance. And be ye lifted up. That's telling us about the control. Then it tells us about you comply with the control. You see the command to obey the communication that he's hearing. Then you see the control to comply with the control, the opening and the entry. Then finally you see the connection. In that passage again, you see the comprehension. You connect because you can comprehend. First, let's look at the command through the communication. Command through communication. In Psalm 24, verse 7, I look at part A. It said, lift up your heads, O gates. That's a command. That gate needs to be lifted up. What is gate? We can only get a picture of gate by looking at the image of safety. That when the gate is closed, the people inside are safe. And then, apart from safety, you see that the gate represents the things that are inside the city. And then you realize that there is a kind of communication going on between the city and the external world through the gate. Because we are told in Isaiah chapter 28, I want to read verse 6, part B. It says, a strength to those who repair the onslaught at the gate. So you see that the gate is where onslaughts and problems and evil are diverted. They are taken away from the gate. Then the gate is a place where victorious celebrations are taking place. It's a place where people will gather together to celebrate, to praise, to talk, and to rejoice. Because if you look at Judges chapter 5, verse 11, the Bible says, at the sound of those who divide flocks among the watering places, there they shall recount the righteous deeds of the Lord, the righteous deeds of his pleasantry in Israel. Then the people of the Lord went down to the gates to celebrate the pleasantry, the joy, the grace, the beauty of the Almighty God. So we see that gate is opened and closes. It is a control, like I told you. It is a place of meeting where decisions are made in the land of Israel. You remember the case of David when Absalom was fighting against him. He went to the gate and he saw those messengers that were running. When the first one ran to him, he said, what is the information you are bringing? That one said, I just heard that they were calling you, they are sending a message to you, I just decided to run. What are you running for? No information, says stand by. Then another person was running and coming down. Then David asked him any information, and then they gave him the information. So he received that information at the gate. The watchman stays at the gate, control. It's at the gate that you are able to gaze into tomorrow, into the future. Look at what David said. In 2 Samuel chapter 18, verse 24, 2 Samuel 18, 24, the Bible says, "Now David was sitting between the two gates, and the watchman went up to the roof of the gate by the wall, and raised his eyes, and looked, and behold, the man is running by himself." So you see what is going to happen by the gate. Then legislative issues are taking place at the gate. Because in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 19, if somebody has a child and that child is, you know, not doing well, the child is misbehaving, the child is not obedient to the father, the child is not following the rules of the law, the child is just doing whatever he wants to do, in the land of Israel, those days, the father will take that child to the gate. And when the child gets to the gate, the father and the mother shall bring him to the gate, to the elders of the city at the gate of his hometown. That's in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 19. So you see that the gate is where, you know, legislative issues are taking place. Again, you realize that when Boaz was to marry Ruth, decision was taken at the gate. So the gate is the controlling force that allows rules and regulations to be taking place. So you see the importance of the gate. You see what the gate meant to do. The gate is a command that we receive, that the gate needs to surrender, because there is no way you have the gate of your life, the gate of yourself, under your control, and that gate will be good. No. You surrender the gate. The command from the Lord is that, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates." There is need for that gate to be lifted. And because this command is given to the gate to be lifted, there is need for compliance. Because the gate needs to comply. And he says, "And be ye lifted up, O ancient doors." You see, this passage of the scriptures is not talking to the physical gate. It's talking to mankind. Mankind are portrayed as gates and door in the wall of a city. The citizens that makes up the city, they dictate the kind of, you know, the atmosphere, the kind of peace, the kind of joy that you have in the city. And you see that the city, the mankind at the gate and the wall determines the community that you see in that place. So the compliance, when the gate is being commanded, "Oh, lift up your heads, oh ye gates," is simply talking that there is need for every gate, which now symbolizes human being, the controller, and it talks about the symbol of your heart, that your heart will be opened so that the King of Glory can come in. And if the Lord wants to enter into our life, we must open the gate for him to come in. You remember Jesus told us in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, he said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." So you see that Jesus Christ himself is even saying, "Look, I'm standing at your gate. Open so that I can come in. I want to dwell with you." Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door or opens the gate, I will come into him. I will dine with him and he with me." So he's simply telling us there that, you see, when you hear the voice of the Lord, you open the gate of your heart, then God comes in. And you see, you can't be a gatekeeper for your life. No, there is no way you can control your life. That's why something else tries to control your life. Lies, cheating, stealing, all kinds of evil, alcohol, whatever, begins to rule over your life, and then they control you. They control the way you live your life. You give your life to all kinds of things that can affect you, that can
that can ruin that life and destroy that life and take your future from your hand. Because you can't control it as a human being. There's no way we can control our heart. We need to surrender that heart, that life, to God. And through the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the reason why Jesus Christ came into this world, to come and die for us. That's the reason why he came. That you, who have been living a life that is contrary to him, controlling your life, but you can't even control that life. So you surrender it to the one that creates you, the one that made you, the one that formed you. By opening the gates of your heart to him, you give him a chance to come into your life. He said, if you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and I will dine with you. You will dine with me. So this is telling us about giving your life to God, living a holy life, having a clean heart and a pure mind. Because, you know, it's not like the case of Pilate who says, oh, I wash my hands, I'm clean from the innocent blood. But actually, he was the same one that condemned Jesus. So we need to realize that it is the solution to your problem is in your hand. And all you need to do is to surrender your life to God. Let him come in. Let him have mercy on you. He died because of you. He died to save you. You open the gate of your heart to him and let him come in. And we turn that life around and change it completely and turn it completely. Now, the Bible says, you know, who is going to abide in the house of the Lord? Who is going to stay in his temple? The Bible says, he who has walked with integrity and walk in righteousness and speak the truth in his heart. That's in Psalm 15, verses 1 and 2. So these are the kind of people that can dwell in the place of God. These are the people that, you know, needs to, you know, when you open your life to him, he cleanses you in and out. He changes you in and out. So you need to comply. He wants to take control of your life. You know, you can't control your life. He needs to take over your life. He needs to control your life. He needs to guide your life. No human being can lead and control your life. Only God, only Jesus can do it for you. So you need to surrender that life to God so that he can be able to come in into your life. And the moment you have Jesus in your life, he takes control of your life. He leads you in the right way. He leads you in the right direction. He shows you the way you are supposed to go. Then number three, comprehension. Because when we are talking about connecting with the external world, you know, your help has to come from outside of you. You now realize that you can't even help yourself. You can't even assist yourself. There's no way you can even come to help yourself. So there is need for you to connect to the one who has life, to the one who creates life, to the one who has made you, to the one who has formed you in the belly, to the one who has given birth and brought you out into the world, to the one that gives you ear to breathe, eyes to see, ears to hear, and the one that gives you strength to be able to walk, the one that makes the heart to be pumping blood all over your body. You need to surrender that life to him. You know, the psalmist asked a question. He said, who is this one that I need to surrender myself to? In verse 8 of Psalm 24, he said, who is this King of glory? The Bible answered by saying, the Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. You see that Jesus Christ is the one that can actually, in all seriousness and sincerity, help us out of every problem that we have. Jesus appeared in the temple at the age of 12. He spoke to the knowledgeable ones, to the wise ones, and he told them about the scriptures. When the mother and the father were looking for him, he said, why do you keep on looking for me? Mustn't I go about my father's business? So he has a business that he wants to do. And he said, I came into this life to rescue and to save all day that are lost. It's not the will of God to come into the world to condemn you, to destroy you. No, not at all. But he has come to encourage you, to tell you how his power can save you. So you need to comprehend and try to go in connection with the one who can make everything. What do I mean by comprehend? You need to comprehend with his glory. The Bible tells us in John chapter 2 verse 11 that Jesus started his ministry, and the beginning of his ministry is with signs that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. So you see in this passage of the Bible that Jesus Christ did and showed forth his power. If he turns water to wine, it can change your life from the problems he's carrying and change it to a new life. It can give you a second chance. It can turn you around. It can change you around. It can make you a new creature completely and totally. Now, let's look at the glory of Christ that we are talking about. Talk about his moral glory. He proclaimed the spotlessness of his holiness. The Bible tells us Jesus was the Word, and he came in flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, the glory as of the begotten Son of the Father. This glory of Jesus is full of grace and truth. So you see the moral glory of Christ. You see the beauty of Christ. You see the grace of Christ. You see the anointing of Christ. You see his beauty. How he's making us to understand that this God, you need to comprehend him. Comprehend his moral goodness, his moral holiness, his beauty, his grace, his truth that he has come to share with you in life. And when you comprehend him, then it's essential to your victory to overcome all these obstacles that you have in life, to set you free, to deliver you. And that's the reason why he has brought you there. Not only that, the grace of God, the glory of God is a moral grace, a moral glory. No, again, it's a majestic glory. Number one is moral glory. Number two is majestic glory. That is, he's telling us the excellence of his words. That this Christ, what? All the excellence. Peter told us in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 17, he said, "For he received honor and glory from God the Father, such an utterance as this was made to him by the majestic glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." So that is the testimonial of the Father concerning him. Majestic glory, mighty glory that he has come to share with you and to share with me. Number three, it's not only that we have him as moral glory or majestic glory, we have it as marvelous glory. The glory of Jesus Christ is a marvelous one. And that is telling us about, the gospel is telling us that the gospel is sufficient in his atonement. That all that you ever need is contained in the gospel. All that you are looking for is contained in the gospel. Now, running from pillar to post, looking for solutions to your problem, you don't need to do all that. Confess your sins to God. Turn to Jesus. The moment you turn to Jesus, you become a child of God. You have access to the Almighty God. You call upon him in the day of trouble, he will deliver you. He will set you free. He will give you a new life. You will have access to heaven. You'll be able to talk to God and be able to receive an answer from the might and the grace of God. It's a kind of what you call a marvelous, sufficient glory. It's a marvelous glory that is sufficient for all your need. Everything you need is contained in the gospel. He sees you through. Not only that is limited to this world, even after you have finished your assignment in the world, he opens the heaven for you. This is the glory of God that we are talking about. Number one, it is a moral glory. Number two is a majestic glory. Number three is a marvelous glory. Number four is many-sided glory. It's a glory that has very many diversions. Healing is there. Deliverance is there. Salvation is there. Freedom is there. Prosperity is there. Goodness is there. Mercy is there. Freedom is there. Speed is there. Favor is there. All these things are contained in the glory of God because it's many-sided story. It's many-sided glory because His truth declares the immutability and the infallibility of His power. The power of the Lord can never in any way be exhausted. He has everything. All power in heaven and on earth belongs to Him. He controls everything by His power, by His might, by His grace, by His anointing. That is the glory we are talking about. Many-sided. Look at how the psalmist put it in Psalm 108, verse 5. Psalm 108, verse 5. The psalmist said, "Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and your glory above all the earth." Everything on earth is under the glory of God. He can take control of everything. No matter the challenge you are facing, no matter the problem you are facing, no matter the trouble you are facing, our God can take control of every challenge that you are ever facing. Not only that, is not only that, the glory of God is a moral glory, like I told you, a majestic glory, like I told you, a marvelous glory, like I told you, a many-sided glory, like I told you, and it's a mighty glory which declares the miracle of God, speaks about the strength of His power. Our God is powerful. Say it. Our God is powerful. Then you need to tap into this glory. Look at what He said in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. He said that He will grant you according to the riches of His glory to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in the inner man, that you will be strong inside of you. No matter the storm that is going on around you, you will be strong inside of you. You'll be able to demonstrate the glory of God. You'll be able to demonstrate the power of God. You'll be able to show forth the anointing of God that He gives to His own children. I'm praying that this grace of God, this glory of God, the moral glory, the majestic glory, the marvelous glory, the many-sided glory, and the mighty glory of the Almighty God will be your portion as we pray together now. My brethren, lift up the gate. You need to comprehend what God is saying. You need to comply to His commandments, and you need to follow all that God is telling you. What a communication we have. If we don't tell God what we are facing, how do we get solutions to the problem that we are having? Speak to the Lord. He will see you through. He will assist you. I give you this 1 minute. Tell Him about that. Tell Him about your mind. Tell Him what you are feeling. Tell Him you have come to Him, that the gate is open. You can't help yourself. You have come to Him to help you. You have surrendered your life to Him. You have repented of sin and turned unto Him. You want to have a clean hand and a pure heart. You want Him to come and dwell in your heart and rule in your heart and reign in your heart. Let Him be the ruler of your life, and it shall be well with you. Let's pray together now. Holy Father, we thank You. We praise You. We worship You. Father, I pray, whatever has been militating against the opening into the miraculous of these people, let Your mighty power break asunder now.
Let your glory shine in their life. Father, prove yourself. Make yourself known. Let your power be known. Let your glory radiate. That everyone hearing me now, everyone listening now, all of us who are here hearing the word of God, Father, we pray, let your glory break every chain and give us the solution that we need for our lives. We bless you, we honor you. The healing is done. The deliverance is done. Your grace is real. And we tap into your glory. Blessed be your name, O God. For Jesus' precious and unfailing name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much, my loving brethren. Please share this video with your friends and your contact on the Facebook. We love you. Till we meet again next week. In fact, you can't miss next week. Thank you. God bless you. All right. Love you. Bye.